Well, good morning, everyone, and welcome to Emerald Ashbore University. My name is Robin Osborne, and along with my EAB University colleagues, who are Amy Stone from the Ohio State University and Dr. Cliff Sadoff from Purdue University, we welcome you today to this presentation. Today's presenter, you've probably remember from previous webinars, Joe Boggs is here from the Ohio State University. He's an extension specialist and entomologist and has been doing extensive work with ALB and also with some with Emerald Ashbore. He's kind of kept us abreast of what's going on with ALB, and today he's going to kind of bring us up to date. I wanted to remind you before we get started that your comments and questions are welcome, and we want you to feel free to write them in the chat pod on the left of your screen. We're going to make a note of them, and Joe will respond to your questions after his presentation to keep the flow of the webinar smooth. Your feedback is also very important for us to keep these free webinars coming, so please stay tuned till the end, and we will be providing a link to a survey that we hope you'll take the time to fill out. For those of you needing CEUs, I have been informed that you can get them for this live webinar only. if you will look at the left side of your screen, at the bottom there is a note box, and you'll see Amy Stone's email. If you could please email her and tell her that you attended this webinar and give her your information, she will be able to give you, get you your CEUs. We can only give credit for the live session, just as a reminder. All right, this webinar is being recorded and it will be available on the www.emeraldashbore.info website here and probably within the next 24 hours. We thank you for attending today. We hope and we know that you'll be learning a lot from Dr. Boggs. So with that, Joe, welcome, and it's all you.
All right. Well, thanks a lot, Robin, and I appreciate the honorary doctorate. It's just Joe Boggs. I'm with Ohio State University Extension and the OSU Department of Entomology. And I recognize a lot of folks on the webinar today. So to get started with my update, you know, the first update relative to Emerald Ashbore and Asian Longhorned Beetle is the fact that as Emerald Ashbore continues to spread across North America, we're starting to see it more and more often within the areas of Asian Longhorned Beetle. Now, we experienced this in Ohio, with the Asian Longhorned Beetle infestation being just at the edge of where our EAB infestation was creeping eastward. Of course, now the two overlap. This actually did occur the first time in North America in 1998, when Asian Longhorned Beetle was found in Chicago. But of course, as we all know, Emerald Ash Borer was not known to exist at that time in North America. So even though there was an overlap, there wasn't this problem, but this perception problem really leads to some considerable issues. So again, here in Ohio, it's the same as many other states, but what we have different is we have most counties now confirmed to be infested with Emerald Ash Borer. We suspect these counties in white actually do have infestations. They just haven't been discovered yet. But the big point is, of course, our Asian Longhorned Beetle infestation in Claremont County. So that just shows the dot, indicating that Ohio is now EAB and ALB land. Now, if we look at the most recent map posted on the EAB website showing discovery of infestations of Emerald Ash Borer, what I'm going to do is overlay the known areas of Asian Longhorned Beetle. Now, you'll see a couple black dots. I'm going to go to the pointer here very quickly, and you'll see that these dark areas in Chicago and one in New Jersey are where Asian Longhorned Beetle infestations had occurred but are now eradicated. The red dots show infestations that currently exist. And what I want you to pay attention to is the fact that the Emerald Ash Borer dots are very close, if not right in, some of these same areas. So thus, the challenge with people mistaking the two insects. Now, this produces beetle blending, as we've been calling it here in Ohio, meaning that when people say Asian longhorn beetle, it's particularly true here in the greater Cincinnati area, people are often thinking emerald ash borer. And of course, when people say emerald ash borer, some folks are thinking Asian longhorn beetle. Now, you know, working for Ohio State, you know, as we all know, when people say University of Michigan, we can say this is what I think most people are thinking, right? I had to put that in there. That's under contract with Ohio State. The point being is that the reality between these two beetles are, and this is something that is, I believe, a very important take-home message. The reality is that the beetles are, frankly, like apples and oranges. They are very, very different in almost all aspects. I mean, about the only thing we can say that's the same is that they are beetles whose larvae are, you know, behave as borers. And the important point here is that if we should ever have EAB plus ALB going in the same direction, in other words, if Asian longhorn beetle were ever to be allowed to spread the way that we've experienced emerald ash borer, it would be potentially catastrophic. In fact, I should just take that potentially out. I think everyone on this webinar knows that it would be catastrophic based on this particular data that was put forth by Dr. Mike Raup at University of Maryland and others in 2006, showing clearly the impacts of Asian longhorn beetle and emerald ash borer on street trees, and showing the limited street tree diversity, but tremendous impacts, potentially, again, catastrophic. And of course, you know, I think this is all the way that we'd all feel, you know, if that should ever happen, it would be catastrophic. Now, when it comes to EAB versus ALB, and again, I'm going to do this compare and contrast because I think this is an important update. I think it's important in this update to continue to stress that because it has a lot of ramifications, frankly, for both management of both insects. So let's talk first about, of course, emerald ash borer. We all know, you know, the primary genus that it's affecting would be Fraxinus. Now, I think February 26, Don Cipollini with Wright State University is going to be talking about the discovery of the ability for emerald ash borer to infest white fringe tree. Of course, white fringe tree is in the same family as ash, Oleaceae, and it is also one of the closest genetic relatives to our white, green, blue, and black ash trees in North America. So, point being is that wasn't too much of a surprise. So he'll be talking more about that. The big point, though, is if we look at Asian longhorn beetle host trees, and I want to start this off by stressing something that, I'm going to be honest, kind of gets under my skin a little bit. Sometimes you'll see these hosts of Asian longhorn beetle presented this way. You have a column with preferred hosts, and then you have a column that has rare hosts. Now, why that kind of gets under my skin is it implies that the preferred hosts are the top of the line emerald ash or Asian longhorn beetle food, and the rare host is only when starving ALB food. And that is just simply not accurate. That's not a very accurate way to present this. Indeed, if we look at the Asian longhorn beetle host, we have very good hosts, and that's how I like to see it presented, and other hosts. And a very good host, as everyone on this webinar knows, starts with maples. These are the top-of-the-line hosts, if you will, followed by Aeschylus and Ulmus and Salix. Now, you know, some years ago, we were trying to figure out how to differentiate. The maples are slightly better than the other three genera, and I like to use food. I mean, of course, I'm at the College of Food, Agricultural, Environmental Sciences, so let's start with food, and the maples are like porterhouse steak, whereas the other three genera are like T-bone. I mean, no, porterhouse is slightly better than T-bone, but if you're like I am, and I can't get a steak, I'll be happy with hamburger. And that's exactly the way this works with Asian Longhorn Beetle. If there's no steak available, they will go after the hamburger list. And as a matter of fact, why this is so significant is that the poplar listed under other hosts is the number one host in the native range of Asian Longhorn Beetle in China. Of course, those are non-native poplars planted there in plantations, but this just stresses that this beetle will be very happy with hamburger. Now, something else on this list that I want to point out that has changed, by the way, that's if you're counting, this is 13 tree genera. It's something that was just changed 2 weeks ago, starting with the eradication program here in Ohio, is that hackberry has been taken off the list. So for those of you counting, we've gone to 12 tree genera, and the reason being the hackberry was always a bit suspect. And so far, none have been found to be infested in Ohio and I believe elsewhere that confirms this relationship. So with the 12 remaining genera, the eradication programs call these high-risk trees. And why they're called high-risk trees is that each of these genera, or trees in each of these genera, are capable of generating new adults. And if you are working with eradicating an insect, obviously eradication means zero adults. So they're called high-risk trees for that reason. Well, there is good news. And I think this is very good news, frankly. Again, if you consider what emerald ash borer looks like in North America, I have the dots of the current infestations in North America highlighted here. And once again, the reason that that I have this kind of blacked out area is because they're very tiny infestations relative to the geographical breadth of North America. And these dots, as a matter of fact, are not the size of the infestation. I just had to make them big enough so you could be able to see them. So the good news is relatively small, distinct infestations remain. Eradication has been successful. And if we just take a look at some past history, of course, again, Asian longhorn beetle was discovered in Brooklyn in 1996. This is the first time it was found to be in North America. Now, there's an important point that has continued. And I'm going to make note now, we're not going to really talk about this later, but all infestations thus far of Asian longhorn beetle have originated from a single point of introduction directly from Asia. So if you consider all the infestations that I had marked on the previous map, they did not arise from another infestation in North America. And we know this because of DNA analysis. It's called the founder effect. Meaning that each infestation was just started by a few beetles, sort of like families, if you will. As a matter of fact, the variance is about the same as we see with paternity suits. So very slight variance, but it is enough so we can say that the infestations arose directly from Asia. Now, if we take a look at the map as I'm presenting it now, you can see Xing out that even in the original area, in New York City and New Jersey, you can see infestations have been eradicated and they're working to eradicate others. Now, Chicago, if you take a look at the seven areas that had infestation, very widely dispersed, caused great concern. Again, all infestations were connected to a single point of introduction from Asia, but all of these Chicago infestations have been eradicated. I'm stressing this because I consider this to be very good news. If we go to our neighbors up north in Toronto, now in 2013, they believed that they had eradicated the Toronto infestation. Unfortunately, a little later that year, about 15 miles southwest, as that arrow indicates, in Mississauga, they found a connected infestation, and they're working to eradicate that right now. Again, this is very good news on two points. First of all, ALB can be eradicated. It has been eradicated. But I want also for everyone to realize that this has then generated a lot of experience. A lot of experience, particularly by the United States Department of Agriculture, Animal Plant Health Inspection Service. Again, they've been in charge of this in North America and have learned quite a lot that can be brought to bear. Of course, as we know, with emerald ash borer, again, going back to this map, widespread infestations in multiple states, dense infestations. So eradication's not realistic. Once again, though, you'll have people comparing these two beetles. You'll hear statements like, well, Asian longhorn beetle is probably just like EAB. It's probably all over the place. I believe, and others believe, that simply is not the case. We can discover these beetles. We're going to talk more about that later. But if we do say such things, then it does kind of imply, you know, that there's no hope. And again, I don't believe that. Others don't believe that. But it is a big difference between the two beetles. Now, even further, there's the tree-killing behavior, and this is going to connect to management. So we're going to talk a bit about tree-killing behavior, but to do so, just a little short segue here to introduce this subject of an important subject, I believe, tree stem anatomy, the basics. Now, this will be review, I believe, of just about everybody on this webinar. If you take a look, you know, top down, let's say you're looking at a stump. So we're looking at a tree stem. And, of course, as we all know, we have bark, we have a ring of bark, we have a ring of phloem, we have a three-cell layer thick ring of cambium, and then we have xylem. So the cambial, you know, layer is really like slime. If you've ever taken bark off a tree down to the xylem, right on the surface of the xylem, you have this slimy area. That's cambium. By the way, just a little side note, the width of the phloem that I'm showing here, that's not realistic on large tree stems. This would be more like on very small stems, so it's not quite the same size ratio compared to xylem as we typically see. That will be important later, but let's talk about function. Those cambial cells, as I teach, they're kind of magical because they will become eventually the xylem or they will become the phloem. They're like teenagers. They don't know what they're going to be till they grow up. And this is why trees get larger in girth, because that cambium is contributing cells in two different directions, both inside and outside. Now, I call cambial cells magical because if they're exposed to oxygen, you have the generation of a completely different type of tissue on trees. We call wound or callus tissue. Now, for you purists out there, yes, I understand that wound and callus tissue aren't quite the same. But for the sake of this presentation, I'm just going to simplify and just say, well, if a tree, for example, you know, gets struck by lightning, we all know that we can see then the development of this kind of lip-like tissue that we call wound tissue. Now, that's used to try to close that wound up to prevent rot to the interior to help protect the tree. That's how trees close wounds. Now, this is a great wound tissue showing an old pruning wound, and it was properly done so that the cambial cells completely encircling the wound were not damaged. And so they're slowly generating tissue that will eventually close that wound. And this is why, for example, we don't talk about pruning sealers any longer, because that would prevent those cambial cells from being exposed to oxygen. Wound tissue, though, also leads to some other important points relative to detecting borers. Asian longhorn beetle, for example, will spend a little time sometimes, wrecking the cambial and phloem cells, and that exposes those cambial cells to oxygen, and we can see bark cracking. And of course, we pull the bark off, we see the wound tissue beneath. And for those of us working with emerald ash borer for years and years, this has been a common observation. I have the bark pulled off to show the lip-like wound tissue, but of course, that tissue was responsible for this bark cracking, an important symptom for a number of borers. Now, if we go back to this tree trunk basics, now we're talking about the phloem, and we like to teach it as food flows through phloem, both down from the leaves and up. And, this multi-directional flow of the carbohydrates in the phloem, sometimes people don't quite catch on to that idea that, as a matter of fact, it does flow up. Carbohydrates do flow up. And the way we know this is when we put maple syrup on our pancakes. Happening right now in many parts of the country, starting to tap into maple trees, and just emphasizes, of course, the potential impact of Asian longhorn beetle taking out maples. But we're not tapping the xylem. The tappers are drilled into the xylem to hold them in place, but it's actually the phloem flow that we're extracting. Of course, the xylem is where we see nutrients and water flowing up one direction in the tree. And of course, the xylem is very important for the structural integrity of the tree. It's the wood of the tree. But that's not the end of this basics, because it gets a little more complicated. I just presented this like this is how all trees are, but we have ring porous trees and diffuse porous trees. With ring porous trees, here's a list, a partial list. We only have a single ring that's functional. The outermost xylem ring is functional in any season. With diffuse porous trees, and again, here's a partial list, we have 4 to 5 rings, the outermost rings, that are functional. That's going to be very, very important in just a bit when we talk about impact by these two different borers. But it's not black and white. I love this saying. There are two kinds of people in the world, those who divide the world into two kinds of people and those who don't. Point being is that when we talk about ring and diffuse porous, I do want to recognize that we do have some trees that are semi-ring porous and some trees that are semi-diffuse porous. Now, if you take a look at this, there actually aren't too many Asian longhorn beetle hosts on this list, thankfully. We do see poplar and some elms. So that does kind of simplify our discussion. So let's talk about our good friend, the name of this this webinar series, Emerald Ash Borer University. Let's talk about emerald ash borer and how does it work. And again, this should be review, but it's important to start with this idea that ash trees are ring porous. So the beetles, of course, select the tree and the larvae feed on the tree. And if we take a look again at the cross section to talk about graphically how this works, we can see that eggs are laid on the bark. I want to emphasize that. Emerald ash borer lays eggs on the bark, bark crevices. Not particularly selective, but it's on the outside of the tree. They don't chew into the tree. They lay on the outside. Those eggs hatch. And the larvae, even though it would appear that they are feeding on the xylem, as a matter of fact, they're primarily phloem feeders. Again, I want to emphasize that these graphics are making the phloem appear much larger than they actually do in a real mature tree or even partially mature tree. Point being is, if we look at this image taken of a nice feeding track, larval feeding track of emerald ash borer, we can see to the right, the larvae were simply not large enough in girth to start etching that outer ring of xylem. But as they got larger, you know, they did start etching the outer ring of xylem. But they're primarily, once again, phloem feeders. The position of the larvae in the phloem account for also why woodpecker damage is very, very shallow. The woodpeckers are going after a phloem feeder. Now, of course, as we all know, eventual damage is that the plumbing of the tree is wrecked, wrecked fairly quickly with high populations, leading to this this phenomenon we call synchronized death, where we see a large number of trees going down at one time. As we all know on this call, the synchronized death showing this street, for example, in Toledo, where these trees actually looked pretty good the year before this image was taken by Dr. Dan Herms with Ohio State. And this, of course, as we all know, produces a heavy burden on urban forestry programs removing these now dead and dangerous trees. But it's also very important that we all remember that insecticides can protect ash trees. And the reason is pretty darn simple there. And that is that the phloem is an effective zone for systemic insecticides. Now, it's my understanding that we don't have a really good understanding of why systemic insecticides work the way they do work. However, suffice to say that we do know that our systemic insecticides are effective against phloem feeders. So when we apply a systemic, either pouring around the base of a tree, injecting into the soil, injecting directly into the tree, of course with Safari you can spray on the trunk of the tree. And for a list of these, the website where you access this webinar, emeraldashboard.info, has this second edition. I want to stress that if you haven't updated yourself on that, you need to know, listing these products. And as we all know, if we do apply systemic to an ash tree, we do have protection in the phloem. and that does protect ash trees. So, if we look at the trees on the left, those have been treated. The trees on the right have not been treated. So, insecticides can protect ash trees against emerald ash borer. But it's important to remember that the goal is only to maintain full canopies. Those trees on the left could be, there could be a percentage of an infestation occurring, but as long as the canopy is healthy, who cares? We're achieving the goal of maintaining a full canopy. It's not to kill every beetle. This is not eradication. And I want to stress that because, once again, when people confuse the two beetles, they will believe, you know, that the two goals are exactly the same in terms of what the reaction to these two beetles. And, of course, they just simply are not. So if we take now a look at the subject of our webinar, Asian longhorn beetles, the first point is that they go after, of course, a primary host, being maples, which are diffuse borers. And, of course, stressing again, it's the adult beetle that selects the tree. It's the larvae that's feeding inside the tree that causes the damage. Now, I'm going to show this kind of slowly, where we have eggs laid on the xylem surface. Now, if you recall, with emerald ash borer, where did they lay eggs? On the bark surface. This female took 18 minutes. I timed her as she was chewing through the bark down to the xylem surface to lay a single egg. So she takes a long time to lay one egg, which partially accounts for slow population buildup between Asian longhorn beetle compared to emerald ash borer. They are just simply, Asian longhorn beetles are simply much, much more deliberate in their egg-laying strategy. This is showing a first instar larvae sitting right on the xylem. That surrounding tissue is phloem. Now, that larva can do one of two things. It could spend a little time feeding on the phloem. I'm using the pointer to show that. It could, I can't seem to capture the pointer. At any rate, it does have the potential of spending a little time in the xylem or in the phloem, or, and this is always going to be the case, it can go right into the xylem. As a matter of fact, it will always eventually go into the xylem. Asian longhorn beetle larvae are primarily xylem feeders. This is what it looks like in terms of real life. Now, eventually you do see damage, enough damage to the phloem and enough damage to the outer ring of xylem that we see some pretty significant damage. But as you notice, there are still large areas of the xylem that remain functional because this is a diffuse porous tree. You can see the wreckage here being caused by larvae, but these trees were still alive. As a matter of fact, if you take a look at this tree in Worcester, Massachusetts, and you can see the canopy is only now starting to thin a bit, and this is believed to be within, I think, maybe, as I recall, less than 100 yards of the building where it is believed that Asian longhorn beetle was first accidentally introduced into Worcester, Massachusetts. So very high population densities at that location. And look at this tree. Still has a pretty full canopy, relatively speaking, and look at all those holes. So we spent all this time teaching everyone to look for thinning canopies for emerald ash borer, which remains true, because they're going after a ring porous tree and there are phloem feeders etching into that first ring of xylem. But the take-home message is that thinning canopy is not at all a reliable diagnostic symptom for detecting Asian longhorn beetle. What is accurate, though, is that you see a lot of damage to the xylem. So look at the ends of branches, particularly broken branches. That's take-home message number two, because as Asian longhorn beetle feeds on the xylem, it's weakening the structural integrity of the branches. And so in every case, including our own infestation in Ohio, broken branches have led to the discovery of other infestations. So what we're teaching people to do, particularly arborists, is after a windstorm or an ice storm or some snow loading event, for example, and we see branch breakage, to stop and take a look at the ends of those branches, particularly on trees, again, that are alive, maple trees that have live branches and live broken branches. That would cause great concern because we just don't have native borers that do this type of damage. So in terms of tree borer behavior and management, we have to now talk about this challenge with insecticides. We know that the xylem is not an effective zone for systemic insecticides. Again, as I understand it, we really don't know why for sure, but it is a fact that was known even before Asian longhorn beetle was discovered in North America. Longhorn beetles, cerambycids, the family, were always very, well, almost impossible to control with systemics. So if we take a look at this entire area I have in red, that's out of reach of systemic insecticides. If we take a look at this final stage larva, final instar larva of Asian longhorn beetle, what's going to happen even if I treated that tree with a systemic insecticide? That larva is still going to develop, eventually pupate, develop into an adult, and that adult can leave to go find another tree. So insecticides for ALB are problematic, and that's the right word. It leads to a eradication challenge relative to insecticides. Now, eradication, remember, requires 100% control. And as those on this webinar know who have spent time doing efficacy work with insects, we seldom, that's just almost an impossibility. It's just, we just don't achieve that with insecticides alone. But what is the role of insecticides relative to Asian longhorn beetle? Well, it turns out adults do some feeding. They have very powerful mandibles. And it's important to note that the female Asian longhorn beetle in particular, when she emerges, she spends a little time doing what we call maturation feeding, meaning she's trying to gather reserves, trying to gather food to mature her eggs. And if you notice, she strips the bark and feeds on the phloem. So insecticides, particularly imidacloprid, because that's been the one most tested thus far, simply because the tests have been primarily conducted in China to do complete trials, that we do know that adults can consume some systemic insecticide and be killed during maturation feeding. But it's important and extremely important to note that the efficacy trials have not provided 100% control. Studies have ranged from 50 to 90%. However, even with that, because 50% is still better than 0%, imidacloprid has been used in ALB eradication programs in conjunction with other tools. And of course, as we all know, the other eradication tools for Asian longhorn beetle, the primary one is a chainsaw. Chainsaws are used to take down infested trees. The trees are ground up, converted into mulch that can have a size range of no more than 1 inch in two dimensions. And this is considered to be non-regulated material. So this is safe to use, but that's the eradication program using chainsaws, and it does have a significant impact, obviously. Take a look at this woodlot. That you can see the woodlot behind it, the trees that are now gone in the foreground, was about the same density. If you look at this home, for example, and all of these maple trees marked to be removed because they were found to be infested, it does have a significant impact. If you look at Google Earth, for example, now, the same location I still can't get the pointer, but if you look kind of down in the center, you'll see a row of trees. Now, I'm going forward to 2012, and you can see those trees are now gone. That row of trees that I showed in the previous image. You look at the top of the image, you can also see a woodlot that has had a lot of trees removed. So, again, the eradication program does have a significant impact on those that are experiencing the program. Of course, you know, we also have to look at it as a necessity to try to obviously avoid Asian longhorn beetle escaping to cause the same catastrophic impact that we would have in North America, as we've seen, in fact, even more so than emerald ash borer. So let's talk a little bit about what is happening here in Ohio as a case study, if you will, for an eradication program. Now, if you take a look at the areas outlined in red, you'll see some yellow dots in the one on the right. That's where the core infestation was originally found. Now, the other two areas outlined in red were where infested material was taken prior to the discovery of Asian longhorn beetle in Ohio. Now, as you recall, that's tracking with how Asian longhorn beetle has behaved elsewhere. Prior to the discovery of the infestations, material was moved. But those infestations originated directly from Asia. We know from, again, genetic analysis of the adults that our infestation arrived directly from Asia. And then we see these two satellite infestations. Thus far, we have almost a 1.5 million trees have been surveyed. Now, I want to stress that this is a time-consuming effort. This isn't just walking by trees and looking up and saying yes or no. This is done, of course, by trained, well-trained personnel. I'll tell you, I don't consider myself qualified, even though I've been looking at a lot of trees and talking about this for quite some time, but I'm not as good as the surveyors, and I'm an entomologist. You have to really spend some time being trained, and it does take time. So far, 15,846 trees confirmed infested, 14,537 infested trees have been removed, 48,000 high-risk trees have been removed as of just a few weeks ago, and 26,291 high-risk trees have been treated, and treated with insecticides. We'll talk more about that in a minute. But let's go to this high-risk tree removal. Remember, that includes the 12 tree genera that are considered to be high-risk trees because they can contribute to producing new adults. Why do we see the high-risk tree removal as being part of an eradication program? Well, that's because of another eradication challenge. It has to do with a detection challenge. And if you take a look at the tree on the left and the tree on the right, the tree on the left is a red maple, the tree on the right is a silver maple. Now, I do want to kind of stop for a second. You're seeing a thinning canopy on that heavily infested tree. Well, it turns out that really has nothing to do with Asian longhorn beetle. The homeowner there indicated to me and others that they do a lot of parking of cars around that tree when they have a lot of company. The fact of the matter is that tree was declining because of other reasons. It had a couple of big stem girdling roots, of course, that we see often on silver maple. So the decline really didn't have to do with Asian longhorn beetle, we're quite certain. But that tree was heavily infested. And so the point between heavy and lightly infested trees was driven home by our group that visited that day. We looked and looked and looked on that red maple and failed to define any indication of it being infested. Now, I have to tell you, this was in 2011, and it caused me to even kind of go in the wrong direction of some conclusions. I was thinking, well, maybe red maples aren't as good a host. Well, that's simply not true. Fact is, it tells us two things. Number one is the beetle does spread slowly. You see, those trees are almost touching. Secondly, that tree, it turned out, we had a USDA APHIS person that was with us, and then he stepped back and showed us with binoculars that there were some oviposition pits. If you remember, the adult female takes her time to chew these pits to lay an egg, and there were a couple of pits on that tree making the red maple infested. So what does this mean? Well, there have been studies conducted showing that positive identification of ALB on lightly infested trees is a real challenge. Highly trained ground surveyors are only about 20 to 40% effective on discovering an infested tree if the tree is lightly infested. And, of course, well-trained, experienced climbers are only 65 to 75% effective on lightly infested trees. Now, if we just kind of do a little math here, let's pretend we have 100 lightly infested trees. And so we discover that we have some infested trees by ground surveys, but our ground surveyors are only going to be 20 to 40% effective, so on average 30% are detected. Now, let's say the rule is that we only take down known infested trees. That means 30 trees are going to be removed based on our survey. Now, we don't know, though, that 70 trees remain infested, are infested, but were undetected. We don't know this at this point. But let's say we suspect there may be more, so we send in the climbers, the experienced climbers. But even the experienced climbers are only going to be about 70% effective. So let's say we follow our rule. We're only taking down confirmed infested trees. And that means that there remains 21 of our 100 lightly infested trees that are undetected. What's going to happen to those 21 trees? Thus the point with high-risk tree removal. High-risk tree removal is performed because we know that whenever we have an infestation, there's going to be some lightly infested trees around that core zone and elsewhere. And so high-risk tree removal is a preventative eradication action. It's saying that within a certain distance of a known infested tree, we know they're going to be lightly infested trees. So in this case, the high-risk trees were removed. Now I'm circling where this was done or has been done in Ohio. And you notice the first circle, the green area, that's actually around a place called East Fork Reservoir, and that's a state park. The reservoir is managed by, and the park is managed by the Ohio Department of Natural Resources. The dam and the reservoir is managed by the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers. And of course, as we all know, you do not want to have a lot of canopy loss, tree loss around a reservoir. That can lead to other problems. So high-risk tree removal was done there. And high-risk tree removal is being offered to landowners even around the core zone. It's not mandated, though. And that's an important point. It's not mandated. But as you saw, because 46,000 trees have been removed, I think that was the number, some folks had taken that option. Now, insecticides are also being used as they've been used elsewhere. That's a very important point. Insecticide treatments have been used in every ALB eradication program. So in Ohio, for example, they've been used thus far in the satellite infestations. Now, the reason for that is, number one, as I said earlier, 50% efficacy is better than zero. But they're not being used, the insecticides are not being used where we have heavily infested trees. So those insecticides are not being truly challenged, but they are an added preventative measure, hopefully, to try to keep beetles from spreading. Now, this is a common question, and I want to cover this in this update because it's something, once again, that compare and contrast between emerald ash borer and Asian longhorn beetle. Who's paying for the eradication, and who's in charge of the eradication? Now, in every case, the primary funding source is going to be USDA APHIS. The secondary funding source is going to be the regulatory agency in that state. For example, here in Ohio, it's Ohio Department of Ohio Department of Agriculture. In Indiana, where Cliff is located, it would be the Ohio Department of Natural Resources. So that would be the secondary funding source. It's important to note, though, that these are tax dollars. These are your dollars as well as my dollars. And the reason why I'm emphasizing this is because sometimes we all believe, you know, when we have a problem elsewhere, well, that's someplace else. We really don't have a say. As a matter of fact, everyone on this webinar, no matter where you're located, since U.S. tax dollars are being used, you do have a say. You do have, and also you have a say in terms of potentially what could happen. Who's in charge? Well, again, this is going to be a partnership, and it's worked very well here in Ohio and elsewhere, between USDA APHIS, the federal authority, and the state regulatory agency. Of course, that would be the Ohio Department of Agriculture here in Ohio. Now, there is an important point here in Ohio, and I don't know how this translates elsewhere, but it turns out that our Ohio revised code, the legislative action that governs all this, actually does specify that the ODA could order landowners to remove infested trees at the landowner's expense. Now, so far, that has not occurred in Ohio for Asian longhorn beetle. But why I'm emphasizing this is we go back to EAB versus ALB. In terms of tree removals, we all know this is a state park or a city park in Cincinnati, and look at all the ash being taken down. So in state and municipal property, who pays for it? It's public dollars. It's not going to be dollars coming from the state or federal government. If it's on private properties where we see dead ash, it's going to be, of course, private dollars. Now, it's important to note this because we all, and many of you probably have already gotten these calls where folks are dealing with dead ash trees and they don't have the money to take them down, but they've heard that, this non-native beetle, there's money to take down trees. Well, that's only been with Asian longhorn beetle, and that's an important point to emphasize. Well, finally, in terms of ALB detection, I held this off to the very end because I want you all to have fresh memories of this. In terms of an update, you've probably seen before, but it's never a bad idea to reemphasize the fact that the primary ALB detection method remains eyeballs. It remains looking for the beetle. Now, I didn't put this in my talk. There are studies being conducted that have been conducted looking at traps and attractants. And thus far, nothing has panned out in terms of both traps and attractants. I remain optimistic. There have been indicators of chemical communication going on between males and females or between the beetles. And the point being is maybe this will be cracked. That would be a great way to detect the beetles, but thus far we have to use our eyeballs. Now, in terms of what this beetle looks like, it is called a longhorn beetle because of these long antennae. That is consistent throughout most of that family, Cerambycidae. There are a few longhorn beetles that don't have such long antennae, but this is a female, and you can see the antennae are extremely long, and these are huge beetles. These are going to be some of the biggest beetles that you would ever see. Look at this male beetle, my colleague Eric Draper trying to coax it down from a tree. Huge beetles. The females are even bigger. Look at this. I'll tell you, we taped this. This is really, Cliff Sadoff is over for that. Seriously, Asian longhorn beetle is a huge beetle. Now, there's a female with her long antennae, and there's a male in my hand, and I have fairly big hands. Male antennae are even longer than the female antennae, but this, again, is a huge beetle. I want to emphasize the collar pattern. If you take a good look at this, I'm going to go back to the female. I think it's even better. You'll see, well, that way I'll go forward. You can see it on this male. So with the male, you'll notice that you have this shiny black background and these indistinct white splotches. They're not quite spots. They're sort of indistinct. For those of you who are artists, you know that there's a technique where you can rough up a paintbrush and kind of dab on color. And that's exactly what this looks like. I understand there's a common name in China for this beetle that translates to starry night beetle. I also understand that's not true throughout China, as common names are applied here in North America. They vary geographically. However, that common name really clearly describes this beetle. You know, it looks like a starry night. It's very black background, these white splotches. The antennae have alternating black and sort of bluish white bands. And if you notice on the legs, you have kind of bluish white tint to the legs. Now, and of course, I forgot about this being shown. So here's that female again. You can see these features very, very clearly. Remember that in your mind. We really don't have another longhorn beetle that looks anything nearly like this. Now, the larvae of Cerambycidae present a challenge. They're called round-headed borers because of this very large round first thoracic segment. The head's actually there kind of right next to my thumbnail. But the point being is they're called round-headed borers because of that very large thoracic segment. They look like Michelin men, but the challenge is this. You can go out in the woods today. Now, of course, it's -1 here in Cincinnati. Probably not too many people out in the woods, but you could go out in the woods and look at dying and dead trees and branches, and you could find similar-looking larvae. I mean, larvae would actually look almost exactly the same. That presents an identification challenge. We can use larvae to identify ALB. It's going to be done by DNA analysis, but it's not going to be your primary way of saying that's Asian longhorn beetle. Now, if you did find these Michelin men larvae in a known live maple branch, well, then again, that would be a cause for concern. But as we all know, you know, dying and is a sliding scale, so you can start seeing our native beetles We used to call them the cleanup crew, native longhorn beetles, infesting branches, producing larvae that look just almost exactly the same. So here's what you're going to look for. Very distinct round holes, and these holes extend deep into the tree. Remember, ancient longhorn beetles are a xylem feeder. If you look at a cross-section and inserted pencil, you can see why we call this the pencil test. Because the larvae are feeding on the xylem deep in the tree, the woodpecker damage is very, very deep, which, of course, contrasts greatly with the woodpecker damage we see with emerald ash borer, which is very, very shallow. Oviposition pits. Now, the tree will respond by closing these pits, producing wound tissue very, very rapidly. However, and of course, this occurs, I should have mentioned this, on the life cycle. This is a hot-loving beetle, so we see maximum beetle numbers out in July. And at that time, of course, this damage can be reacted to very quickly, but you do see pits, and you might see some weeping coming from these pits. Again, there's the female chewing that pit. Frass by Asian longhorn beetle is produced not only by excrement, but also by pieces of the tree. The female produces frass. For example, if she was chewing this, she was knocking down this excelsior-like material that collects in the crotches of branch breaks and also at the base of trees. Be looking for the beetles and the larvae. Of course, again, be very careful about the larvae. And bark splitting, and of course the biggie, the really big thing, is branch breakage. Look at the ends of broken branches. Very, very important. Of course, I want to reemphasize, it remains true that Asian longhorn beetle infestations are relatively small and they are distinct. The goal is eradication, and eradication has been successful, but the key is early detection, both in terms of the time it takes to eradicate and the cost of the eradication, and of course, obviously, the potential to spread. So be on the lookout for Asian longhorn beetle and report suspected infestations. Now, I want to run through this very quickly. This is the six steps in confirmation of an Asian longhorn beetle infestation. The first is, of course, reporting a suspicious tree or beetle. In our case, to the Ohio Department of Agriculture or to the USDA or to USDA APHIS. Now, this may vary elsewhere. Even here in Ohio, for example, now a person could report to me or others with the Ohio State, but of course, ultimately, it's going to go to the regulatory authorities, ODA or USDA APHIS, so frankly, it's better to start there. And then a regulatory officer will investigate. In this case, in Ohio, it could be ODA or it could be APHIS. So that's step two. Now, what they're going to be looking for are exit holes, oviposition pits, beetles, and larvae. If only holes are found, other trees will be examined. Now, as you could guess, the trees that are going to be most closely examined are maples. The goal for confirmation is to find beetles and larvae, because that's the only way to absolutely confirm. Now, if beetles are found, a positive ID is made by morphometric examination and DNA analysis. Now, what we're saying is, frankly, just measurements and the appearance of the beetles. The larvae would be identified by DNA analysis. And finally, step six, if it's confirmed to be Asian longhorn beetle, a public announcement is made. It's a couple of points I want to stress here, though. Beetles and larvae are sacred for confirmation. The holes and other indicators are not going to be something we're going to say, or it's going to be said, well, this is positive. So that means if you do find beetles and larvae, preserve them. Alcohol is considered the best way to do it, ethyl alcohol. However, the next best is to freeze them. Now, if you would find suspicious larvae, or if you would find a beetle, get it in the freezer. Get it in the freezer quickly. Now, as one of my colleagues pointed out, you don't want to transport a beetle in a plastic bag. They can chew out. So get them in something like a jar, stick them in the freezer, keep them there until you contact the regulatory authorities, the proper authorities, to make arrangements for them to get the sample. Don't take them out before that arrangement's made. The overarching point is to do this, report, and don't speculate on confirmation. even if you're in the middle, I would urge that you hold off, because again, until the DNA analysis is done, until it's absolutely positive for larvae, until the adults are absolutely identified, we cannot speculate. We shouldn't speculate, which means stay up to date and don't spread rumors. For example, some of you saw this. This went around, this was passed around in a number of email lists. In 2014, this article appeared in the Taos, New Mexico News. And you can see the author, I have highlighted that they contend that it's likely that people will probably encounter Asian longhorn beetle in Taos County, New Mexico. Now, that's absolutely false, absolutely untrue. As a matter of fact, the article is interesting because it went on to say that he grew up with Asian longhorn beetles. So obviously something strange going on in New Mexico. But the point being is, this is not helpful. A saying that I love to teach is one of my favorite sayings: everyone's entitled to their own opinions, but not their own facts. So let's focus on just the facts when it comes to Asian longhorn beetle. Keep yourself informed and updated. This was a hands-on field training exercise that was done in the infestation in Claremont County, Ohio, some years ago. Attend classroom-based training, and we would urge that it's produced by a non-biased research-based source like your universities. And finally, this is an extremely important source of information. This is the Asian Longhorn Beetle. If you look, it's all one word, asianlonghornbeetle.com. So if you go to this website, you can keep yourself up to date. What's very important about this website, and again, here is the website. I would urge that you remember this. It's all one word, Asian Longhorn Beetle. This shows, for example, information specific to Ohio with our project manager doing a great job, Phil Baldoff with USDA APHIS. And I want to emphasize that the bottom of that website, have you seen the beetle? So you can initiate a report right from that website. Well, that brings us to the end of the presentation today. And hopefully you've learned a lot. And this is time now for some questions.
Joe, thank you very much. We do have a question from Rachel. She wanted to know, is each satellite population within Chicago, for example, then introduced by a different beetle from Asia? Or do you mean that the Chicago area as a whole was initiated with a single Asian beetle?
Oh. Excellent question. The Chicago infestation was initiated by single beetles. Now I'm saying beetles. I mean, it could have been a gravid female with eggs. But it obviously had to take a male and female, otherwise, at least, you know, two beetles, Adam and Eve, if you will, beetles. So the Chicago infestation was started with a few beetles directly from Asia. And then, of course, before it was known that the beetles were there, the material was shipped around. And I want to stress that Chicago was 1998, so that was only 2 years after Asian longhorn beetle was found first in North America in Brooklyn, New York. A lot was not known at that time. You go back and read about it, a lot was learned very quickly. Frankly, that was quite an effort and a very successful effort. Another follow-up, though, to that, and I should have mentioned this, anytime an infestation is declared to be eradicated, that's not the end of it. There is still monitoring going on in the Chicago area. So once eradication occurs, there remains monitoring just to make sure.
Look-alikes for ALB. Do we have a document or something maybe online where people could look for something like that?
Yes, there. If you do actually search Asian longhorn beetle lookalikes or Asian longhorn beetle, confusion or something along that line, there have been produced some online documents showing some lookalikes. I didn't include them in this presentation. Probably should have in retrospect, just to demonstrate that, frankly, you know, it's the so-called lookalikes, the white spotted pine sawyer, for example, one that kind of has blackish with a single white marking, is sometimes reported. It's probably one that's most commonly reported as Asian longhorn beetle. However, again, if you look at the two beetles side by side, they just don't look anything at all alike. On the other hand, and I should stress this, if you do find a large, or anyone else, I mean, we would rather have a non-ALB reported, you know, and we find it's not a, we would much rather have that than for someone to actually have Asian longhorn beetle found and think, well, this doesn't look like it. We'd rather have the negative. So I would emphasize to others, you know, don't hesitate to send.
Okay, we have a couple of questions here on insecticide controls.
That's also extremely important.
One person wants the kind of a review of them, and then what? Another person is asking, what is the typical method of insecticide treatment for HRRTs?
All right. Well, first of all, remember, you know, that we're dealing not the same as with emerald ash borer. So control is not the right word, and I used it, but, you know, we're hoping to have prevention going on. It's not going to be nearly as effective as, of course, with emerald ash borer, because this is a xylem feeder. We've had the most data generated on imidacloprid, so that would be the merit-like materials. In terms of application methodology, both soil drench has been used with high-risk tree treatments, as well as direct injection with imidacloprid. It is unfortunate that there has not been, in my opinion and others, you know, a little bit more work done on this, only because we have new neonicotinoids. But remember, it's very difficult to do efficacy insecticide research in you know, when the rule is that infested trees are going to be removed. Of course, we all agree with that rule, but if you're doing a trial, you've got to have what we call control trees that are untreated, and that simply cannot be allowed in North America. Thus, the best data has been coming out of China, but that's expensive to do. I actually kind of urge people to consider, you know, and again, these are tax dollars, you know, talking to people that might have influence to say more work might be done in China to learn a little more about this, but it is expensive. There's also another challenge, and that is the efficacy work that has been done there, simply because our native maples aren't growing there, has been primarily done on poplars, elms, and willows. And of course, you know, those trees aren't quite the same as maples, but still, you know, it's better than what exists right now.
Okay.
Hopefully I answered the question.
There's a question about, do you know anything about the Quebec province in Canada that has EAB?
The Quebec, well, what we do know, the Quebec that has EAB.
Oh, I'm sorry, ALB. I'm so used to EAB.
Okay.
I'm sorry.
No, I'm sorry. That's more than... Okay, so I'm not aware of anything in Quebec. That I'm not aware of. I haven't seen any reports on that. We do know that, as I indicated, the Toronto infestation was thought to be eradicated, but... Mississauga was a suburb of Toronto, very close at hand. I have not seen a report. If somebody knows about that, it's boggs.47@osu.edu, boggs.47@osu.edu. I'd like to hear about that, but I'm not aware of it.
I'm not quite sure if you have this information, but one person wanted to know if you knew how further infestations from Asia of ALB are being prevented.
Oh, that's an excellent question. Prior to 2006, our regulations shipping between countries throughout the world, not just our regulations, the regulations governing shipping throughout the world, agreed to by multiple countries, were pretty loose. I just have to be honest with that. For example, prior to 2006, it was okay to ship out of Asia and claim that that the cargo would be fumigated on the high seas. And of course, as we look at these big container ships, as we all know, that's just virtually impossible. After 2006, those regulations were tightened up considerably. So in terms of prevention, I'd have to say, of course, you know, it's not going to be perfect, but it's certainly much better than prior to 2006. I do want to emphasize, though, that the thing that worries us, and why that this webinar is so important, we hope others, is that, you know, what happened before 2006? Are there other infestations? And one thing I want to stress is don't just look at where the infestations exist now. As Cliff and I have talked about in Indiana, it's just as likely, probably far more likely, for ALB to appear somewhere in Indiana on its own from Asia than ever spreading from Ohio. In fact, you know, I think it's now very unlikely, hopefully, that it would spread from Ohio. But be alert that it could be behind you instead of in front of you.
Okay. Matthew wants to know, do you know of any classes being held for the special/advanced training for the ALB detectors? There are tree stewards in our area that would be interested. He said, should they contact local state foresters?
Yes, I mean, I think that's always a good option. Two things, though, that are developing. I should say this. I and Amy Stone and Nancy Taylor with Ohio State University Extension are working right now to develop, and we actually have a grant, a Farm Bill grant, to develop a first detector training, the National First Detector Training, online training for Asian longhorn beetle. Now, the goal is to have that up and running by this summer, so we're working on the presentation right now. As a matter of fact, you've pretty much seen a major part of that presentation that will be available online with notes, so that people can download the presentation with the slide notes to be able to present it to others or take it online. So that's the status thus far. I'm not aware of an online training that exists now that's consistent. On the other hand, if you go to that Asian longhorn beetle APHIS site, that is rich with information. I would urge that that in terms of a follow-up that folks consider that. And again, you know, if you want to have local training, it's always good to start with your local regulatory authorities or your foresters or your university extension personnel to make that happen.
Okay. Steve wants to know, is ALB sound detection still being used, and is it practical?
Excellent question. That looked pretty good early on, both sound and, of course, using dogs. Dogs were very effective. Of course, they can't go up in trees, so that was for material that would be on the ground. That would be like packing material, for example, where dogs could were very effective. But, of course, out in the woods, that has limited availability. Now, in terms of practicality of using the sound detection, again, you know, you're talking about going out in the woods and using this on individual trees. I think it's far more efficacious to use the binoculars and climbers for looking for Asian longhorn beetle. I don't see the sound detection as being that practical. It hasn't been used, to my knowledge, in our infestation. It's the trained ground crews and the climbers that are confirming trees to be infested or not.
All right. Sounds we've had some great information. We're already getting some great feedback. They love your presentation today, Joe, and I really appreciate you giving us your time. I've got to wind this up, but I've put your email address there in the notes box, and I've also had it in the chat box in case anyone else still on the webinar needs to get some more information. So feel free to email Cho. And thank you very much again for all this great information. And it's been really very enlightening. So folks, again, I'm recording this webinar, and it will be available on the emerald-board.info site. So,
Robin, before you leave, just let me thank you and the folks that make Emerald Ashmore University happen. I really do appreciate this time to update on what we believe, of course, to be a potentially very catastrophic tree borer. So thank you.
You're welcome. I'm happy to do it. It's been very helpful for us to get some information out to folks that may not be able to, you know, attend live presentations and meetings. So it's good for us too. So, folks, I'm going to be closing down the webinar here in just a couple seconds. So, thanks again. And again, you can see the recorded webinar on.